Cuban, but I'm here to tell you, he stands in no man's shadow. He is a person who is saving and changing lives, and it is absolutely my honor to introduce Brian Cuban.
Thank you. I'm actually the middle brother, so we let's not insult my younger brother Jeff there. Although I look younger.
Okay, I'm gonna say goodbye.
It's truly an honor to be here today. The Suicide and Crisis Center is near and dear to me. And I have three observations to start. One, I think I'm connected to about half the people here on Facebook. Two, I broke the first rule of public speaking, and when you leave here, remember this. Always check to be sure your zipper is up before you walk out. And three, I am only here today because there were people in my life who didn't mind their own business.
That's right.
In the journey to that very dark moment in the summer of 2005 took me through addiction, cocaine, alcohol. I was a quote-unquote alcoholic. Clinical depression dating back to my teenage years, both traditional and exercise bulimia, yes, guys do get eating disorders, self-harm, jail, two trips to Green Oaks, three failed marriages, one more I get a free set of steak knives, and finally recovery. And when I look back at that journey, there were obviously dark moments, and I try to find a sense of humor about it in moving forward. And I want to take everyone back to June of 2006 to illustrate what was some of the quote-unquote insanity of addiction in my life. The Dallas Mavericks were going to the NBA championship for the very first time to play the Miami Heat. My brother Barkley bought the team in January of 2000. And so as you might imagine, it was a very exciting time for the city, for my family, for the team. As you might imagine, I was also going to get some pretty good seats to those games. I had an opportunity to also get a couple tickets for some friends. Some really nice seats there at American Airlines Center. Do you think I gave them to my friends? No. You're probably thinking I sold them on eBay for some astronomical amount. I didn't do that either because that would have been disrespectful to my brother, to my family, to the team, to the city. I took those two tickets and traded them to my cocaine dealer for $1,000 in cocaine. Selling them on eBay was disrespectful, but trading them to my drug dealer was perfectly acceptable. How the mind works in addiction, and as we often know, as we probably know here, there's a very strong correlation between addiction and suicide. My drug dealer shows up at my house. I was a high-class addict, he delivered. I give him the tickets, he gives me this big Ziploc baggie of cocaine. I go running up to my home office, I dump it out all on the table, look at it like I'm Scarface, with this cocaine kingdom, I want to go, hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo. Of course, I had to do some being addicted to it. Cocaine had long stopped giving me the feeling that I've been chasing since I did it in a bathroom of the Crescent Hotel in 1987 and instantly became addicted to it. I had also developed paranoia that often happens with cocaine addiction. Do I hear the cops outside? Maybe the SWAT team's gonna come through my window like at the end of Christmas Vacation. I gather up the cocaine, I put it back in the Ziploc baggie, I hide it. I get in my car, I drive up the tollway to the Home Depot. I buy electrical faceplate outlets, a drill and a saw. I drive back to my house, I go to each closet in my house, bzz, 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 bzz. I drill through the drywall, and I create a fake electrical outlet in each closet in my house. Like the cops, the DEA, the drug dogs have never thought of that one before, right? Thinking like a lawyer. I take the cocaine and I put it behind all these fake electrical outlets. I do some more, again, just shame and pain, chasing that high that was never going to come again, the high that the very first time made me look in the mirror and finally see somebody I loved. Paranoia again. I go back to each electrical outlet, bzz, 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 bzz. I take it all out, put it back in the Ziploc baggie, go up to the toilet, drop to my knees, and flush it down the toilet. It wasn't an epiphany of recovery, it was the quote-unquote insanity of addiction. The next morning comes, and as often happens when negative events get in the rearview mirror, I wake up, there's another game. What an idiot I am. I just flushed all my cocaine down the toilet. Now it was $980 worth of cocaine, right? Another call to my brother. Two more tickets. Another call to my drug dealer. He shows up at the door, like, dude, you did all that? And of course, I'm like, yeah, I didn't want to tell my flesh down the toilet. Yes, yes, I did all that. I'm ready for more. Gives me more cocaine, give him the tickets. Same thing, hide it behind the drywall. Bzz, 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 bzz. Do some just shame and pain and just searching for this feeling of love that the artificial feeling the drugs gave me. Hide it again, take it back out, go up to the toilet one more time, drop to my knees, like I had done so many times, wanting, hoping for someone or something to take away the pain of my depression, my addiction, and flushed it all down the toilet again. They say when Dallas flushes, it ends up in Houston, so some people in Houston don't really like the insanity of addiction. And it wasn't just addiction. By 18 years old, I had developed anorexia and then transitioned into bulimia at a time when nobody was talking about it, for men or women. By the time I was 21, moving into my 22nd year at Penn State University, I was a full-blown quote-unquote alcoholic, binge-drinking alcoholic. By the time I was 27, I became addicted to cocaine. By the time I was 44, I had become suicidal and had decided that I would be doing my family a favor if I was no longer around anymore. And that moment was not the end of my descent. Three failed marriages, all failing because I spent all of my energy trying to pretend that I didn't have a problem, that I wasn't depressed. And when you spend all of that energy, there's no way to let love in and there's no way to let love out. And finally, in 2007, recovery. And we'll talk about that. How does that happen? We've all experienced it. How did I go from a, or we know people who have experienced it, how did I go from a person born in Pittsburgh, PA, the middle of three brothers, very shy, kickball, dodgeball, before Al Gore invented the internet, right? To a person that was so horrified by his reflection in the mirror, so ashamed of what he saw in the mirror, so afraid to even look at himself, he saw a monster that would never be loved. How does that happen? Well, we have to go back to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I'm a baby boomer, I'm 57 years old, the middle of three children. Mark is the oldest, I have a younger brother, Jeff. Mark, as you might imagine, as the oldest, he was outgoing, he was entrepreneurial, he was selling garbage bags door to door, this door to door, that door to door. I remember when our local newspaper in Pittsburgh went on strike, he and his buddies, I think he was like 16, they drove to Cleveland, which was 225 miles away, they bought newspapers, drove them back and sold them on a street corner in downtown Pittsburgh. You kind of knew what Mark was gonna be, and he became that, and a little bit more. My younger brother, Jeff, was a jock, nationally ranked wrestler where we grew up in Mount Lebanon, just south of Pittsburgh. Beer parties, dates, prom, all the things I wanted so badly. I was brutally shy, middle child syndrome. I was quiet, I isolated, I internalized everything negative that was said to me and wore it like a skin tight suit as who I was. And unfortunately, I also had a very difficult relationship with my mom. And I'm gonna tell you about a little bit about this. I want to make it clear to everyone in this room, I do not blame my mother for what I went through. Parents do not cause eating disorders, parents do not cause addiction. The home environment is the home environment. And cycles can be repeated, but it is not, there's a difference between cause and correlation. Okay? It is not cause, but it's an important part of my story. I used to come home in junior high, here we call it middle school, when I used to love to eat Chef Boyardee ravioli out of the can. Do they still have that? And I was a heavy kid trending towards obese. My mother would come home from selling real estate, she would see me doing that, and she would say, Brian, if you keep eating like that, you're gonna be a fat kid. These were the things her mother said to her. These were the things my great-grandmother said to my grandmother. Fat shaming in families is often handed down generationally. My mom had a very difficult relationship with her bipolar mother. Very difficult, very mentally abusive. But as you might imagine, not understanding these things, not understanding the environment, and just wanting to be loved, I grew depressed. And as I look, when I look back on those days, clinical depression had truly set in at a time we weren't talking about it. I began to eat more Chef Boyardee ravioli, and more Chef Boyardee ravioli, and I became a bigger grind, and a bigger grind, and of course what happens when, often when kids start, when you start changing is when other kids perceive the negative at school, the bullying started. Brian, you're a fat pig. Well, they must have talked to my mom, right? Brian, you need to go to Sears and Roebuck. Are they still around? You need to go to Sears and Roebuck and get a bra. Yeah, and I developed a very self-deprecating sense of humor because I didn't want people to know how much it hurt. Because in my mind, the kids who were saying these things to me were the popular kids, the kids who were going to the prom, the kids who were getting the dates, the kids who were going to the after-school parties, all the things I wanted so badly. The need for acceptance. I wanted to be accepted. I wanted to be loved. And so I would just sort of hang on the fringes of these kids who were bullying me. It all culminated one day in what I call the day of the gold pants. My brother Mark had given me these shiny gold bell-bottom disco pants. Who here has seen Saturday Night Fever? Imagine these pants on John Travolta now. That wasn't me. That was not me. I was a heavy kid. These pants fit Mark fine. Mark says he taught disco back then. I'm trying to verify that. I'm calling fake news, but. So, but my brother gave me these pants, and I love my brother. We're very close then. We're very close now, and they were a symbol of his love for me. So I was going to wear those satin, gold, bell-bottom disco pants at school every day, and I didn't care what the fuck kids thought, and I did. And my butt looked like 15 cats back there, and you have to jump up and down with a water bottle. But I didn't care. I stood those pants up in the corner of boredom so much. I'm walking home with these kids one day, the bullies. They're making fun of me, and I'm being self-deprecating. Yeah, I know I'm fat. They decided that they would want to see what I look like without those pants because they were so tight on me that I just had no business wearing at them. And these kids physically assaulted me, and they tore off those shiny gold bell-bottom disco pants. They ripped them into shreds down my Fruit of the Loom tighty-whities, and they threw them in the street, thinking they had done the greatest thing ever. Now, this was back in the 70s. Going viral meant 15 kids in the lunchroom knew about it, right? But it didn't hurt any less. It's all relative. It didn't hurt any less. That's what I knew. I gather up the shreds. I cover up my tidy whities, I waddle on home. People gawk, no one stopped. I get home, house is empty. I take those pants and I put them in the bottom of the garbage, hoping no one would ever say a thing. And I was so ashamed that I didn't know how to stand up to bullies and that these kids had validated everything I had come to believe about myself, that I was a fat pig. And also when I came home with bad grades, my mother would call me a dumb buddy, as her mother said to her. And I'll play with this, this is what her mother called her. And I was a dumb bunny who would never be loved. Not by his mother, not by the girl I wanted to take to the prom, not by the girl I wanted to have my first kiss with. And I didn't tell anyone. And no one said a word. I get asked, why didn't you tell your brothers? Because I was ashamed. Why didn't you tell your father? Well, my father was my unconditional sense of trust and safety. That guy sleeping with my mother in the room next door who was going to make sure monsters from that movie didn't get me that night. In my mind, if I told my parents they were going to give me one of those little poles, bags with a pole on the end of my clothes and tell me to leave, who was going to love me? Who was going to take care of me? And it was right around that time that I remember looking in the mirror and starting to see a monster, starting to see this huge stomach and starting to develop what is known as body dysmorphic disorder well before it was talked about as a diagnosis, which is when people take a smaller non-existent perceived defect in the body and exaggerate it in their reflection to the point where they're unable to focus, when they're unable to function quote-unquote normally in life. They never leave the house. There was a strong correlation with suicide. I went on to Penn State University. and I was so happy to get away from my parents. I was so happy to get away from the bullies. Everything was going to be great. It was going to be a brand new start. My father drives me up to Penn State. I remember it's the first day. The kids, I'm in my new dorm room. I'm ready to make new friends. It's going to be different. I'm going to finally get a girlfriend. I'm going to finally kiss a girl. Kids are out in the parking lot on this beautiful fall day. I remember this long rectangular window, this beautiful fall day. And I make eye contact with this pretty brown-haired girl, as I remember 40 years ago. And I remember within the space of about 10 seconds, I envision my entire life together with this girl. We're going to date, we're going to get married, we're going to have 2 and 1/2 children. It wasn't a smile, it was a smirk. She turned to her friend, turns back to me, put her hand just like this, and goes, "Ugly, ugly." Now, I am not the first teen to have nasty things said to him. Another kid may have gone, "Yeah, whatever," right? And responded differently. But I was somebody who was already broken, somebody who already had a negative self-image, somebody who already did not love himself. And I remember thinking at that moment that my entire life was out of control, that I would never be loved by my mother, by a girl, by anyone. What could I do to get control? What did I have control over? Food. I had control over food. That was it. But I didn't want to eat more because I associated that with being, quote unquote, a fat pig and being bullied. So I started to restrict and restrict and restrict. And before I knew it, in 1979, long before it was talked about, there we go, I developed an eating disorder. And later that year, I transitioned into bulimia, which is the act of binging and purging. I transferred to our main campus at Penn State. I turned 21, and I was old enough to drink. Before you knew it, I was an alcoholic. As a 21 and 22-year-old at Penn State, I was drinking every night. I was drinking during the day. I was binge drinking. Because if I couldn't lose enough weight to be accepted, to look in the mirror and see something I loved, I would just deaden those feelings of not loving myself. I remember the closest I came to thinking about recovery, if you can call it thinking about it back then, was walking to a hamburger joint. The 12-step groups would put out these pamphlets, and the largest 12-step group, obviously the most well-known is AA. The 12-step groups would put out these pamphlets called the 20 Questions, and they were geared towards students. Answer this many questions, and you just might be an alcoholic. Do you black out? Do you miss class? Yes. I'm just a college student. Points. It's funny, I speak to a lot of colleges and some smart aleck kid will always raise his hand and go, "You're not an alcoholic, you graduate." No, I was an alcoholic, I was a binge drinking alcoholic. But I was able to do fairly well at Penn State because I had a gift that I was able to pull it together for a couple nights, pull an all-nighter and get a good grade on the exam. And I also had begun running excessively, 10 miles a day, 20 miles a day. I developed exercise bulimia as well, which is the obsessive compulsive exercise for the primary purpose of offsetting calories. And so let's look at my resume back then. I'm drinking, I'm binging and purging, I'm running 20 miles a day. There were some days I was so dehydrated that I had difficulty getting out of bed and my heart would go into arrhythmia. I was very lucky not to have a stroke. But I did graduate from Penn State and I have to make a decision. What am I going to do with my life? Well, I don't want to go out in the world. I wanted to be a police officer. I was a criminal justice major. That would have worked out well. I would have been the first guy exchanging the mannitol for the cocaine in the evidence room. But there would probably be a feature-length movie about me right now. Right? I'm sitting in the placement office looking through police jobs, and there were two guys from Pittsburgh there. They're talking about taking the law school admission test, and they wanted to go to Pitt Law. Ding, 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 the bell started going off in my head. Not that I wanted to be a lawyer, not that I could get my law degree and change the world, make a lot of money. The bells went off in my head that I could stay in school for 3 more years. I could run 10 to 20 miles a day, I could drink, I could binge and purge, and I wouldn't have to show the ugliness I felt when I looked at myself to anyone. I could repeat cycles. I could repeat the exact same cycle and do what I had been doing. Surviving. That's all I wanted to do, was survive day to day. So I took the LSAT and I did do well enough to get into Pitt Law, and I went to Pitt. And as you might imagine, I wasn't a very good student. In undergrad, you can study all night, take an exam, and do okay. In law school, that doesn't work that way. It just doesn't. You have to study, and you're competing with other people who've done very well. I was not a good student. I went through Pitt Law, repeating the exact same cycles. I graduated by the skin of my teeth. I still have reoccurring dreams about going to get my law school diploma and trying to get it from the dean of the law school. And it's funny, because in reality, I didn't go, I was so ashamed I didn't even go to my law school graduation. Just mail it to me. And I'm trying to grab the diploma and the dean's going, psych, you really didn't graduate. Anyone ever have those dreams about school or grad school? And I actually wake up going like this, trying to grab my law school diploma. But I did graduate, and I had to decide once again, what am I going to do with my life? I decided I would move to Dallas, Texas in 1986 when I graduated. Why? Mark and Jeff, my two brothers, had already moved here. My brother's love could save me. My brother's love could make me love myself. Being with my brother would change my life, would fix me, if only that could fix somebody. If only that could save somebody, whether it's depression or addiction or an eating disorder. But in my mind, just being around love would take care of it. So I packed up, I took the Pennsylvania bar exam, I packed up, I moved to Dallas, Texas, Greyhound bus, with I think I had $200 in my wallet. I moved in with Mark, and it was like throwing gasoline on a fire. Boom! Because these guys, Mark's in his 30s, Jeff's in his 20s, they're out going to bars, they're out dating, having a good time. I fit right in. My drinking escalated, and then in the summer of 1987, I discovered the one thing that for 15 seconds, or however that long that high lasted, I looked in the mirror and I loved myself. And when you spent 26 years, or all of your teenage years and young adult years, hating yourself, was just a void in your gut, that all of a sudden just artificially that love just flows in. It was a feeling I'd never experienced before when I did that first line of cocaine in the bathroom of an old bar called Bonash in the Crescent Hotel. And I looked in that mirror and I loved myself. That guy made law review. That guy is loved by everyone. That guy had a wonderful relationship with his mom. Brian does Dallas, he's ready for as long as the high lasted. And then the high was gone and there was the same Brian in the mirror. So I had to have that feeling again and again and again. I had become psychologically addicted to cocaine, later would become the physical dependence, those are two separate things. The cocaine helped me deal with clinical depression. The cocaine, in my mind, told me I was a better lawyer. In reality, drugs and alcohol disintegrated my law practice. I lost all my clients. My brother Mark even gave me an opportunity because he had a feeling I was struggling. He had me work for him. He put me in charge of his percentage of the American Airlines Center when they were building it. I failed miserably. I was showing up to meetings with Tom Hicks and some of the most powerful people in Dallas in this trailer where they were building when they were finishing up the arena, coked up, hungover, drunk. And I failed, and I was ashamed because I didn't live up to my brother's expectations. I failed him one more time, like when I couldn't stand up to the bullies over the shiny gold Galvano disco pants. And in the summer of 2005, I know, do we need to look? A tough story. We can do some yoga, mindfulness, deep breathing, but I'm standing up here so there's a happy ending. In the summer of 2005, I finally became so despondent. All I saw was a black hole in my future. There was no even day-to-day existence. It was just a black hole that I decided I would be doing my family a favor by taking my own life. And it was close. One of my friends who I dedicated my first book to because of it did not mind his own business. He knew something was wrong. He got a hold of Mark, he got a hold of Jeff. They came into my bedroom, there was cocaine everywhere, alcohol everywhere. I'd taken a bunch of Xanax, there was a 45 automatic on my nightstand that I was ready to use. then cleaned up the scene, they took the weapon, and they took me in my first of two trips down to Green Oaks, kicking and screaming. Kicking and screaming. I just wanted them to leave me alone. I was the black sheep of the family, and I was doing them a favor. Why are they keeping me from doing what, in my mind, I know they want? The projection of suicidal thoughts. But they loved me, and they were trying to save my life. They take me to Green Oaks, and I'm sitting in there in the room with the psychiatric physician, the psychiatric nurse, and my brothers. I'm a lawyer. I know what I have to say so they can't hold me. I'm not a danger to myself. I'm not a danger to others. So my brothers wanted me to be committed, but I knew how to answer the questions. So we did what I call the Cuban rehab back then. They put me in the car. They said, just, we're going to take your car keys. Just stay in the house for 2 weeks and everything will be okay. My family was no different than anyone else. They didn't understand addiction. They didn't understand depression. They didn't understand recovery. They were learning as they went. They just wanted me to live. My only thought at that time was, no problem, my drug dealer delivers. The guy I trade the tickets to. That's all I thought about. Fine. So they take me home. They take my car keys. I was so resistant to being told what to do that the moment they left, I called a cab and we got a new set of car keys. After doing the cocaine I had hidden in the house. And so just to please them, I stayed in the house for a couple weeks and just had my friends come over. And we would just do all my cocaine binges watching Scarface. As if that somehow justified what I was doing. You know, if it was good enough for Al Pacino, good enough for me. And I went back out, drinking and doing drugs, and I started seeing a psychiatrist. Started taking antidepressants, but I was also getting drunk every night. That doesn't work, right? My only solution in my mind was that, okay, now they know. Now I have to distance from them. So I started going to fewer games, Mavericks games. I started to not go to family events. I started to just hang out in my house, drinking and doing cocaine and getting a black market Xanax when I could, and finally just doing it alone, just alone in my house, sitting on this bright red couch watching Scarface. I didn't even have friends over anymore. Addiction and depression. And then in 2006, I was out on one of my week-long birthday celebrations at Candle Room. Every birthday was a week-long celebration of drugs and alcohol. And I met a girl, her name's Amanda. We started dating, she moved in with me. I was still pretty good at being able to put on different masks if you didn't see me on a daily basis. And in my mind, if she moved in with me, I would stop doing drugs. I would stop drinking. That doesn't work, does it? So that was my solution. She can move in with me and then I'll be okay. Like, I can move in with my brother and then I'll be okay. Easter weekend 2007, she goes to Houston, ironically, to visit her parents. I had gone to some bar down at the Ghost Bar. Next thing I know is 2 days later, she's staring down at me. There's drugs everywhere, there's alcohol everywhere. I had a 2-day drug and alcohol abuse blackout. She's looking at me, I'm looking at her, and I'm trying, what lie can I tell to explain what we call in the legal profession an orgy of evidence, that I'm using drugs and things like that. What lie can I tell? Well, she's a lawyer too. She wasn't buying any of it. Take me back to Green Oaks. You've been to Green Oaks? What? Oh, I didn't tell you that? Yeah, there are some things you don't know about my past. So we go back to Green Oaks. It's Easter weekend 2007. She's in the parking lot and she's crying and I'm... Three things occurred to me standing in that parking lot. One, that she was going to leave. I would. She actually stood by me and she stayed with me while I worked on finding recovery, worked on repairing my self-image, worked on repairing the broken trust. But I had to do it for me. I couldn't do it for anyone else. And we ended up getting married after dating for over a decade while I did those things. We've been married now for a year and a half. So relationships, not all of them will work out when addiction. The reality is not all of them will, but relationships can survive it if people do the work. It can happen. The other thing that occurred to me was that there won't be a third trip back here, I'll be gay. And the third thing that occurred to me was thinking about something my father used to say to Mark, Jeff, and I growing up all the time. My father, who's a veteran, still with us, a veteran of the Pacific and Korean War. My father, who was the middle of three boys, like me, who worked with his older brother, Marty, from the end of the Korean War until his brother passed away in 99, fixing cars in the same place in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. He understood the bond of brothers. He understood family. He would say to us growing up, Mark, Jeff, Brian, or Brian, Jeff, Mark, yes, siblings, yeah, they get it wrong. Yeah, Dad, we know, really, okay. Wives may come and go. Well, yeah, for me, they certainly have, but he's just joking. We hope they don't. We hope you have wonderful relationships. Girlfriends may come and go, and again, he's just being tongue-in-cheek. But when push comes to shove, all you have is each other. No matter where you go in life, no matter where your journey takes you, no matter what you're going through, you pick up that phone and you call your brothers and you tell your brothers you love them. You tell each other you love them. You ask if there's anything you can do for them. And I thought about that in that parking lot, that bond of brothers that my father had, the love of family, that he was trying to pass down to us. And I couldn't lose that. I wasn't ready to lose that. You never know what moment in recovery will jar you to take that first step. It wasn't being suicidal in 2005, it was this. The thought that I really was on the brink of losing my family. They still love me, but their families, siblings and family love us unconditionally, but there are going to be limits, possibly, on them watching us destroy our lives if we're not willing to take that first step. And I thought about that. And if you want to know how that gift has taken, all these decades later, 1,200 miles away, Mark, Jeff, my father, and I live walking distance to each other. That is how that gift has taken. And I was ready. The next day, I walked into my psychiatrist's office, who I'd been seeing for a couple years, lying. Why would you lie to your psychiatrist? You're paying him. Well, shame knows no hourly rate, right? Doesn't matter. If you're ashamed, you're not ready, you lie. It's very common. And I finally got honest, and I finally told him everything but the eating disorder. At that point, I knew I had an eating disorder, but I was still too ashamed. I said, God, very stigmatized for men. I said, well, Brian, we have a problem. Paying you for that advice? Yes. We have a lot of things we need to get to, including your relationship with your mother, which I had buried. And we had gone through long periods of time not talking to each other because of the cross guilt and the cross blame, unsaid for her not being able to verbalize what she went through and me blaming her. And so we would have periods where we wouldn't talk to each other. He said, you have to get sober. What about residential treatment? I'm not going to residential treatment. There are no lawyers in residential treatment. I'm a busy lawyer. I had somebody call me that may want to hire me, even though I have no clients left. I'm a busy lawyer. What about 12-step? I can't go to 12-step. I've seen them out there. I drive by. My psychiatrist's office is right next to the 12-step group. I see them. They smoke. They do this. I don't smoke. I can't. I can't go over. I don't smoke. There are no lawyers in 12-step. I walk in there and half of them are lawyers. He said, you have to do something. We have to do something. We have to try something. Are you willing to try something? And I knew I had to try something because I had to show my family, even if that was the motivation that I was doing something. So I said, fine, I'll try 12-step. So he said, there's a meeting starting right now. Just go. For those guys, Preston Group is where I go. And I said, okay. But I'm a lawyer. Yeah, Brian, he goes, Brian, you're not a lawyer. You may have a law degree, but you're an addict. You stopped being a lawyer a long time ago. And that was kind of a profound moment that I remember. I'm like, okay, I'll go over there. And I remember looking down the hallway of the 12-step room and the old smelly cigarettes, doing a couple fake walks down the hall. Oh, is this the deli next door? I just wanted a Diet Coke. And I missed that meeting because I spent too much time milling around trying to work up the courage to go in. But the next meeting I made, and that was April 8, 2007, and I remember going in there, and I was smelly, and I was crying, wasn't sure whether I had a drinking problem or an addiction problem. I just knew that I was in pain. And I knew that I wanted to live. and I was afraid that if I didn't do something, I wouldn't. At the beginning of the meeting, just listening to stories, my story's worse than his, my story's better than his, comparing lawyers, high school students, college students, homeless people, all demographics, comparing my stories. Yeah, I can beat that. I'll bet you didn't trade Coke Dallas Mavericks championship tickets for cocaine. You know, what am I doing here? But I realized, and the message started coming across in that room, that powder to nose, bottle to mouth, clinical depression, the suicidal thoughts. I wasn't the only person in there who had dealt with that and had looked down into that abyss. All the stories may be unique in some way, but we were all the same. And at the end of that meeting, they asked for whoever wants to take what's called a desire chip to symbolize a desire to stay sober for 24 hours. And I was thinking, man, 24 hours would be good. Maybe because I had hundreds and hundreds of those, I'll never do this again relapses. 24 hours would be great. And I took it. And since then, April 2007, I have not had a drink. I have not tried cocaine. I have been in therapy for 15 years. Everyone should get some therapy. I'm a true believer in it. I take antidepressants to control my clinical depression because sobriety and depression can exist independently. Sometimes people think they often go hand in hand, but they can exist independently. I have had to deal with clinical depression sober. And I'm very grateful to getting the therapy and doing those things. And I had to deal with the relationship with my mother. And I was very fortunate because my mother was willing to step into my recovery and explain to me how she was raised, explain to me the mental challenges she went through that I didn't know about as a young boy, the verbally abusive relationship with her mom and the cycle she repeated, the fat shaming of her mother, the intellectual shaming of her mother. And once I understood that, she wasn't apologizing, she wasn't making excuses, she was just saying, this is the way it was for me as a young mother in the 70s. I was able to forgive. And when I was able to forgive, I was able to let go of the anger. And when I talk about that, I'm not telling anyone what forgiveness should mean to them. Because people go through horrific things, and everyone has to decide what it meant to them, but what it means to them personally. For me, it meant letting go of the anger. Something that had been driving me and part of driving my destructive behaviors, not all, just a part of it, my anger, my guilt. And once I did that, my mother and I have a great relationship today. She's come to several of my talks. It's funny, I recently got a friend request from the guy from the drug dealer who delivers on Facebook. I said, dude, hand-to-hand exchanges at SMU University is not a friendship. If you're coming to me in recovery, I'm all about it, right? Because everyone has a past in recovery. I think he had a new shipment in. So, and I am Facebook friends with a couple of those kids who ripped my pants off. I get asked, don't you want to confront them? Don't you want them to know what they did to you? No, these are 57-year-old men. They're not 14-year-old kids. They have children and grandchildren. What I hope for them is that they are not repeating cycles. I mean, this isn't a reality show. I'm not the father of Maury Povich, right? We don't need to do that. I just want them to have happy, fulfilling lives and hopefully teaching their children differently than they were taught about bullying. And my recovery continues today. I still deal with clinical depression. I take antidepressants every day. I talk to my inner child. I write letters to my 13-year-old self telling young Brian that he was loved, that he was enough. And the goal of my doing that is as I repair that little Brian, I am repairing myself. And everyone in here knows somebody who is dealing with that little boy or that little girl. Suicide does not happen in a vacuum. There is a story to it, and the story may be different for everyone. The little boy or the little girl who's hurting, the boy or the girl who's bullied. And what was said to start this event, I cannot stress it enough. You do not have to have a counseling degree. You do not have to have any initials next to your name to use the one gift that everyone in this room has to change someone's life, the gift of empathy. The ability to say, how can I help you? I see that you're struggling. And 9 times out of 10, I see this with lawyers all the time. They're terrible at this. Leave me alone. If lawyers are worried about minding their own, what if I'm wrong? Is it going to sue me? Is it going to yell at me if I say I see you have a problem? 9 times out of 10, somebody may not be ready. And you can't make somebody be ready. But that one time when someone says, I've just been waiting, yes, thank you, then you can take that journey and you have changed a life. Thank you.